Well, we're building a garden in memory of Liberty Hyde Bailey, because our teacher thinks it's really cool. We're going to, like, help plant the stuff, and we're going to help water it, and then, like, by next year, this whole area will be full of, like, gardens and flowers and stuff like that.
So this is the area that's eventually going to be the Liberty Hyde Bailey garden.
Interpretive path is to create as many different plant societies as we could accommodate on a piece of property that was given to us to use. And the idea of a plant society are plants that grow in different environments. As we were walking in here, the first environments that we encountered were kind of sunny, open, upland areas that are fairly well drained and would support plant material that would grow in a sunny environment. As we're in the woods here, this is called an understory environment. And what we did was limb up the trees, and we've got the brush cleared out, and our plan is to install interpretive areas here that would include plant material that would grow in an understory or a shaded environment. In this area here, I would envision another demonstration plot that would deal with perennial plants that grow in shaded areas that actually have a flower. What a lot of people don't realize is that there are plants that'll grow in the shade that produce flowers, and will flower at different times of the year, and that's to attract insects and such for pollination. As we're walking along, we're kind of getting into a lower, wetter, a little more boggy area here. We would raise this area up with the wood chip so that you could walk through it and not get wet. But ultimately, what we'd be planting in this area are plants that would normally grow in a wetter environment in a shady area. Plants that are more adaptable to swamps and lowlands. And that would be a great opportunity to learn those sorts of things, like pussy willows. There's all kinds of plants that'll grow in an area that's saturated by water. Keeping in theme with using some of the materials that we've had to take down or clear, and using them, recycling them in nature, we've taken these logs and these limbs that we've taken down and kind of used them as a border against the wetland. But ultimately, we'd be having our wood chip path come through here, and this area would mostly be left to its own devices. There are plants that are coming up. There's perennials in here that are growing in this very wet, boggy area. This is an area where frogs, turtles, snails, and other animals will tend to congregate and can be studied by the students and enjoyed as well. We've noticed in here, we've actually got ferns starting to emerge that are growing naturally here. We've got mosses in this area. This kind of lends itself to a demonstration site where fungus, mosses, decomposing organisms could be cultivated. So I'm envisioning that's the type of demonstration site that we would have here. We would probably have a log or two that would be allowed to have various organisms decomposing it and returning it to its natural state. Again, our path, our wood chip path, will continue through here. We'll take it along the bank. This is an area, this is a little bit more of a defined swamp. It's continually wet and has a little more water in it than the previous area that we looked at. There's some cattails in the background. There's some native grasses in the back. All of those will be subjects for study, and the path will come right up to here. I envision putting some logs along here and just getting it set up so that students or anybody that's interested in looking or studying this area can get as close to it as possible without getting wet. Again, there's different animals that would live in this type of an environment versus the previous boggy area that we saw. You might see more crayfish and such that like a little deeper water. But ultimately, this is a whole other community, and the types of plants, the willows that are growing in the water here versus the red osier that we're growing over there, lend itself to a different plant environment. And this is, quite honestly, a whole different society of plants than one would find over there. And that's what we want to demonstrate to anybody that we're walking through here as well. Liberty Hyde Bailey was a big believer studying natural plant societies in their own environments. As we go through this area, we're starting to move out into another area of the site that we're going to have demonstration areas. And this is kind of a hill that goes up. The path will come through here, and we will have installed timber stairs that can be walk up the side of the hill and get to our next level. One of the things that's important to know is that the use of wood chips, besides the fact that it's recycling something that's already here to use as our path, also is a good material because it doesn't harm the trees or the plant material, or I should say the roots of the plant material that you're putting it over. It actually provides a cushion so when people are walking through, the trees that have sensitive root systems won't be bothered by that. So that's another reason we're using wood chips as our path material. as we're walking through here, we're now going through a totally different environment than we've been either on the other side of the woods or down in the understory. We're starting to get into kind of an upland, grassy area, and this supports a whole host of different types of plant material for observation. One of the first sites that I hope to see over here would be a demonstration area that would have native sunny perennials, plants that come back on their own every year, that have different colors, flower at different times of the year, and have different growth habits, but yet grow naturally in the environment. So we thought that this would be a good area for study of that as we move through it. And again, our path would just kind of skirt along the edge of the woods here. This area here is kind of a mixed, it's sort of a border zone where you have a little bit of shade and a lot of sun, and that actually will support other types of plant material. And what I was going to put in here were a few ornamental trees that again grow native in the environment, but also produce edible berries and have value to wildlife in and of itself. One of the types of plant material that we were going to put in here was something called a serviceberry tree, and again, that's a great plant not only in the landscape, but it's great in the native environment because it gives it provides a fruit that both animals and humans can eat. Okay, as we walk through here, on this side, I was going to construct a demonstration area or an observation area of grasses. Grasses, much like you see growing here, grow native in our environment, and they are excellent plants to study, given the fact that they consume very little resources in terms of water or space, yet provide a significant amount of foliage in terms of for color and for the landscape as well. There are many different types of grasses that have extremely interesting attributes, such as their seed heads and their flowering that grow from 8 inches to 6 feet. And people probably see them in the landscape and don't realize that they're even part of the grass family. But grasses are something that can be enjoyed and studied as well. I also envision getting some native blue stems and some prairie grasses to kind of show what might have been growing here prior to this area having been disturbed for construction and development. And in this area here, that kind of brings us into our next area. I was hoping to have a demonstration site that would exhibit native meadowland plant material. There are grasses, there are also native meadow plants, many of which that flower, that would have been growing in this area, again, prior to development in Bailey's time, that would have had, acres if not miles of expanses that provide color, but most importantly, grow in the environment that existed here at that time. So this particular area here, especially since it's high and dry, would be an ideal spot to have a demonstration site that would include native plant material.
Is that wildflowers, that kind of thing?
Wildflowers, meadowland plants that reseed themselves and are perennial in nature. Some of them would be perennial, true perennials, in the sense that the plant itself would just green up every year and produce more flowers. Other plants would actually cause themselves to go to seed, then die, and then regenerate from the seed. As we were walking out here through the path, I wanted to have a demonstration site that would have some bulbs. Bulbs were a plant, many bulbs were cultivated, but many plants grow, such as sedges and things like that, grow from bulb versus a root. And it's kind of a neat thing to be able to see how this type of plant grows versus other plants that have roots and spread via that method. Additionally, bulbs can be taken out, relocated. Plants can be duplicated by splitting the bulbs, and I think that's a good thing for the students to enjoy. And again, in this particular area, cultivation of bulbs, especially in the Holland area, has been a very big part of this community and the agricultural industry here. But there are bulbs that grow native in the environment. There are plants that grow in meadow areas that come from bulbs, and I think it's just something that would be very nice to enjoy. And again, in this particular area, cultivation of bulbs, especially in the Holland area, has been a very big part of this community and the agricultural industry here. But there are bulbs that grow native in the environment. There are plants that grow in meadow areas that come from bulbs, and I think it's just something that would be very nice to enjoy. Basically, the determination of the path, or the beginning from this side of the path, ends up right here on the road. So the path would come out here, and people could either return via the path or walk the road right back to the bus stop.
Thank you, Mr. Begettis, for showing us that trail and for working on this. I can't wait to get started. And, boys and girls, one of the reasons we're telling you this is because you have the opportunity to come out and be part of our groundbreaking on May 28th at 1 o'clock. Bring your family, and you can even bring a dandelion to plant in our first garden, the Edible Wild Plant Garden. And in just a minute, we're going to show you how you can dig up a dandelion and bring it with to school.
Okay, we're going to kind of demonstrate on how we can transplant our dandelions that we would want to bring to the groundbreaking. But essentially, this is your average size dandelion that you might find now in your lawn or your garden or in your shrub bed. But ultimately, when you're going to transplant it, you want a cup that might be about this big. This is, you know, maybe an 8 or a 10 ounce cup. Okay, dandelions have a very long taproot, so as much of it that you can get, the better off you will be. But essentially, you'll want to take a trowel, okay, just kind of work your way around, all the way around the dandelion. And probably something in a 5-inch diameter. Okay, just loosen that soil up all the way around. Okay. Once you got it loosened up, you're going to go ahead and just pull as much as you can. And what you'll see, and actually we got it all, there's no root sticking out, but sometimes a root can go down about 18 inches. But if you get this much of it, you'll be just fine. And then just put it in your cup.
Boys and girls, if you want to join us, you can come without a dandelion, but if you'd like to plant a dandelion, you're more than welcome to bring your own plants from your own yards and plant them in our garden, and you can watch it grow throughout the rest of the school year, and you can come by in the summer and check it out too, and in the fall see if it's still growing. So we hope you can all come out to our groundbreaking. Thanks.